Hello, today in this video we shall discuss about the CFT, that is crystal field theory. In my last video I have discussed about the postulates and limitations of VBT. There are a few limitations, and that limitation is overcome by this particular theory, that is CFT. So crystal field theory were developed by H. Bethe and V. Bleck in 1935, which proved to be far more successful in explaining the bonding and properties of coordination complexes. According to this particular theory, the interaction between the central metal ion and ligand is purely from electrostatic interaction. The theory explains the condition and situation of the orbitals in a given ligand field. So theory successfully explains the drawbacks and limitations of VBT, the factors which was really failed to explain by the VBT will be explained by this particular theory. And now we shall discuss what are the postulates of this particular theory. And the postulates of CFT theory, here goes. The first postulate says that in complexes, central metal ion is surrounded by ligands. The second postulate is the ligands are considered as the point charges. Third postulate says that if the ligand is an ion, the attraction towards the cation is that between any oppositely charged particles. As I mentioned previously, according to this particular theory, the interaction between the metal and ligand is because of electrostatic interaction. That means just how interaction takes place between the positive charge and a negative charge. Meanwhile, the same interaction will be between the metal and the ligand. If you consider ligand as an anion, that means negatively charged, then attraction towards the metal ion should be interaction like between the cation and anion. If one is negatively charged, then other has to be positively charged. This is the meaning of the third postulate. And the fourth postulate says that if the ligand is neutral molecule, you know there are different types of ligand, cationic ligands, anionic ligands, neutral ligands as such. If the ligand is neutral, if the ligand is cation, then or anion, if the ligand is anion, then the interaction between the ligand and a metal ion is like between two opposite charges. If the ligand is neutral, then the negative end of the dipole is attracted towards the central metal ion. If you consider the metal ion as positive one and the ligand as the neutral, the negative end of the dipole will attract towards the positive end. And example is ammonia and water, or aqua, we say it as amine and aqua. And the fifth postulate says that it successfully explains the absorption spectra of the coordination complexes which was failed to explain by the VBT, that is the absorption spectra. It successfully explains the absorption spectra. And the sixth one says that it explains the reason behind the colored nature of the solution of the coordination complexes. Colored nature of the coordination complexes is explained by this particular spectra, theory which was failed to explain by the VBT. And we know this is one of the main criteria, because the transition metal complexes exhibit color, and we know the potassium permanganate, potassium dichromate, these are colored in nature, and that was failed to explain by VBT, and this proved to be successful in explaining these factors. It clearly explains the magnetic behavior of the coordination complexes, which was failed to explain by VBT. In one of the limitations of VBT, I mentioned that the magnetic behavior and geometry is sometimes misleading. So here, this particular CFT will explain the magnetic behavior of the complexes irrespective of the geometry. These are the important postulates of the CFT based on which we are going to study CFS. Now, what is CFS? So that I'll discuss in my next video. But this forms a basic for CFS, that is the crystal field splitting. Before going to crystal field splitting, I'll just mention. I want to mention the orientation of the d orbitals. Now you know each subshell will have its own orbitals orienting in a space in a different axis. It may be along the axis. It may be it may be between the coordinate axis. And this particular topic, that is orientation of d orbitals, it forms the basis of crystal field splitting. So the d subshell has five important d orbitals, that is the dxy, dyz, dxz, dx square minus y square, dz square. Now five d orbitals can be divided into two groups depending upon the nature of the orientation in space. So one of the group comprises of two orbitals which are oriented along the axis, that can be considered as eg, that is the orbitals are dx square minus y square, dx square minus y square and dz square. These are a set of orbitals which are orienting along the axis. So if we concentrate here, eg orbitals, you can look over here, dz square, where it is orienting along the axis, along the z axis, and here it is dx square minus y square. And other group consisting of three orbitals, that is dxy, yz, xz, which orient in between the coordinate axis. This is here, you can see here t2g and eg. Eg is here at t2g. Look over here, xy, it is the orbitals are oriented in between the coordinate axis, that is xy. And if you look at here, it is xz. The orbital is being orienting between the coordinate axis x and z, and here x and y. These are the two set of orbitals. The d orbitals can be, the subshell or d orbitals can be divided into. And this important factor, that is eg and t2g, it is very essential in order to study the CFS. Why? Because when we discuss the CFS, we don't consider it as dxy, yz, xz, but we all over we say that t2g and eg, that is two set of orbital, t2g and eg. So it is very essential to remember the orientation of d orbitals in order to study the CFS. In this video I've just discussed about the postulates and orientation of d orbitals, which forms the basic of CFS, and in my next video I'll discuss about the elementary idea of CFS. Thank you.